Are there any effects for the invitation to be here and speak at what's going to, so far, been really interesting and confusing? I'm a neuroscientist, cognitive neuroscientist by background, and I'm going to be talking to you about the effects of physical activity on the brain and thinking and learning skills, and try to start thinking about the implications that might have for education. So I'll start by giving some general instruction to this area and then tell you a bit about specific trials that we're engaged in running a trial for a bit to study. And the colleagues that I'm name checking on the title slide here and just a subset of colleagues who've been involved very heavily in that trial, which is ongoing. And I particularly want to thank Thomas, who's here this evening, who will be having to talk more to the trial. And we're going to have a my team. Very hard on this trial and these slides are rather than finish in the form of the thank you very much. Okay, so let's start with a few definitions to make sure we're all on the same page. So when I'm talking about physical activity, the definitions that we're using in relation to that, physical activity, you all know what it means, but strictly we're talking about any body movement that results in a substantial increase in energy usage. In the physical activity literature, often distinctions are made between different degrees of physical activity, different intensity of activity. And we hear a lot about MVPA, which is moderate to vigorous physical activity. So lots of the public health guidelines or guidelines around the amount of activity children should be doing in their everyday life or in school setting is around the amount of MVPA, so around the amount of moderate. Doing and broadly what that means is activity that starts to make your heart beat faster, starts to make you breathe more heavily. So it's things like brisk walking, jogging, it's not going for a very leisurely stroll. So it's activities that really get your heart working harder. There are recommendations that the government give that recommend the levels of physical activity that we should be engaging in. For children, for any age children, the recommendations are that they should be engaged in 60 minutes of physical activity every day. Unfortunately, very small numbers of children in this country and worldwide meet those guidelines. So here's some data for England, which show you the proportions of young people of different age groups that meet this guideline of 60 minutes per day. And you can see that so this is going sort of throughout secondary school age. You can see that even when they come into secondary school, less than a quarter of them are meeting those guidelines and achieving 60 minutes of moderate to vigorous physical activity per day. And then that drops off throughout those secondary school years, and it particularly drops off for girls. So by the end of GCSE year, less than 10% of girls are meeting those targets around there. So, children aren't doing the levels of physical activity that the government thinks they should be doing, nor adults, by the way, they're even worse. But that's a different talk, but we all should be doing far more physical activity than the vast majority of us are doing. So, yes, we know that. We know we should all be doing activity, we know we should all be eating more and drinking less alcohol, there's all these public health messages that we know are out there that we don't follow. What's this got to do with education and classrooms? What's this got to do with academic outcomes, if that's what you're interested in? Well, so we know physical activity is good for our physical health in general, but I also want to give you some evidence today which shows that it's not just good for our physical health and well-being, but also for various aspects of our health, well-being and thinking skills that are relevant to educational and academic outcomes. So for one thing, clearly does have effects on our brains. So we all know physical activity is good for our heart, for our bones, for keeping our weight in check. But neuroscience research increasingly suggests that physical activity might have beneficial effects on our brains and also on our thinking skills in such a way that might be relevant to our children's education. So there's lots of evidence that physical activity boosts our brains. So the kinds of things that neuroscientists have shown are that when there are increases in physical activity levels, we see evidence for new brain cells, new neurons forming in the brain, for growth of vasculature, so growth of blood vessels in the brain, the new connections forming between neurons, the synaptogenesis, so the connection, the junction point where brain cells talk to each other is the synapse. We see more synapses growing, increased physical activity. We see more production of proteins that help the neurons function and survive. And there's evidence for all of these things from a number of different places in the brain, but one area that keeps cropping up in much of this evidence is a brain area highlighted here called the hippocampus, which is an area that's involved in a number of different functions. Some of the things it's involved in are connected with learning and memory processes. So this just gives a very broad brush view of the ways in which activity might influence our brains. I wanted to give some of you a flavour of the type of evidence that we're talking about here, particularly for those of you who aren't neuroscientists. I think it's useful for you to get a handle on what is the evidence base out there for these kinds of relationships. So how do neuroscientists gather evidence about the effects of physical activity on thinking skills, for example, or on the brain? So one thing that's important to appreciate is that there's different levels of evidence that neuroscientists can get about this. And that might range from experiments that we would do in a laboratory setting, for example, comparing mice that are exercising by running on running wheels compared to those that aren't, through to experiments you might do in the university laboratory, for example, getting young people in to do physical exercise in a research gym setting, through to real world evidence that would be gathered in the classrooms. And one really important point is that each one of these levels, I believe, is really important. So they obviously all have pros and cons to them, and they have advantages and disadvantages. But to get a full picture of what's going on, we need to study these types of phenomena at all of these different types of levels. And that's because these different kinds of experiments give us different types of evidence, all of which are relevant to the debate. So for example, if we do experiments on rats, comparing rats that run on a running wheel to groups of rats that don't, we can have a very tightly controlled environment. We can even control the genetic makeup of those animals, for example. And then we can look not only at the behavior of those animals and how well they do on thinking tests, for example, but we can also look at their brains under a microscope after the animals have been killed, so that we can then see the effects on individual brain cells and neurochemistry and blood vessels and all of those basic biological processes which underlie our thinking and learning skills. So there's a lot of types of evidence that are relevant to neuroscience that can only be got through doing these invasive studies in animals, for example. However, ultimately, those of us who are interested in education want to know about effects in humans, in children in our schools. And there's clearly a leap from a rat running on a running wheel through to children, a child in a classroom. And we need to understand the relationships between those different brains in order to see the relevance of the studies in animals to the studies in humans. But clearly there is, in addition to lab-based neuroscience experiments, there's a lot of need for experiments in human pupils. So by bringing students into laboratory settings, we can tighten control the types of activity that they're doing, for example. We can do all sorts of monitoring of things like their heart rates and their energy usages. We can take lots of sophisticated measurements. We can do things like scan their brains and the brain scanner to see the effects that the activity is having on their brains. One really important thing to note, though, is the kind of information we can get from our brain scanners is at a very different level than the kinds of information we can see in the microscope. So again, just to underline the point that we need both all of these different levels of explanation to get a full understanding of what's going on. And then obviously ultimately we need to be doing experiments in the classroom, in real world settings, to actually figure out what's feasible, what's scalable, to what extent is the evidence that has been gained in the laboratory relevant to what's possible and achievable in a real world setting. And yes, we do need, we may need to get evidence about brains and how brains are changing, because that gives us insight into why there might be a relationship between physical activity and containment, for example. But ultimately, we need to know how a given type of activity changes the children's behaviour and thinking skills. So there's a lot of work which uses things like cognitive tests to try and tap into children's attention, levels of outcome measure, as well as different styles of experiments. Okay, so just to give a few little highlights of the types of evidence that these kinds of studies have produced, then, which reiterates the summary slide that I gave you at the beginning. So experiments in rats, for example, have been able to show at the level of individual brain cells how exercise changes the brain. So this is evidence that we describe as being a cellular. So on the left, for example, you see examples of neurogenesis, so growth of new neurons. So under a microscope, we can inject things into a rat brain, which allow you to highlight new brain cells. So that then you can look under a microscope and count the number of new brain cells in groups of large numbers of animals that have had the opportunity to exercise versus those that haven't. And what you find is that in animals that have exercised, you have far more new neurons than those that haven't. On the right is examples of quantification of new synapses. So these are the connections between brain cells. So a given neuron, so a given brain cell, can have many, many, many synapses. And so on the right, what we're seeing is that neurons that existed before grow many new synapses after exercise. And that these are all examples from within this brain structure of the hippocampus that I mentioned earlier. So our brain is phenomenally plastic. You heard about plasticity earlier on from Paul's talk, and this is an example of, this is sort of you visualizing plasticity in action. So you do something and your brain physically changes its structure as a result of that activity. So in this case, your brain is growing new neurons and it's growing new connections between neurons, and you can see that directly under a microscope by doing these types of experiments. In studies in humans, so we can't look at the level of individual brain cells or at the level of individual connections, but we can zoom out, if you like, and take cruder measurements non-invasively using our brain scans. And that's what we do a lot in my group, where we use brain scans to look at how, in this case, the structure of the brain is altered as a result of physical activity. So here are some examples from our work as well as from other groups showing in adults, in this case, the effects of physical activity on brain structure, on the size, the overall size of that brain region called the hippocampus that I mentioned before. And what you see in the top graph is the results of an intervention study in older adults, where you can see in the red line here that in a control group of older adults, we see the unfortunate shrinkage of our brains that will happen to all of us gradually over time. So above, say, around 60 years of age, our brains gradually shrink year on year, so that's the default scenario. But you can see that in older adults who engaged in a physical activity intervention, you've done a number of hours of physical activity over 1 year, that usual shrinkage that you see is halted, and in fact is reversed, so you actually see an increase in the volume of that structure in older adults. And there's been a lot of other studies of this type, and a lot of interest in this area, potentially as a way of slowing cognitive aging, protecting even dementia. Although, as with everything that I'll tell you today, there's need for more, bigger, better evidence to really come to town, but there are hints that in older adults, exercise may promote healthy brain aging, if you like. In the lower graph, that's a result of a study that we did in younger, middle-aged adults, so people between about 20 and 45, showing that even a very brief exercise intervention, so in this case taking sedentary adults and engaging them on a daily 6-week intervention, made them fitter and increased the volume of this same brain area of the hippocampus. So there is evidence, the vast majority of adults rather than young people, suggesting that exercise changes our brain. We presume these are positive changes, but that's something that we can debate, but exercise seems to robustly increase the volume, particularly in this area of the hippocampus, and potentially also other brain areas. So what's this got to do with education? We can show pretty pictures of brains, we can show blobs on brains, in this case our blobs on brains are brain areas that are growing rather than brain areas that are active. For this to be relevant to education and teaching, we want to know whether it actually has any effect in how well the children are doing at school, what they're feeling about school. So So there we need to turn not to pictures of brains, but to data on thinking skills and academic outcomes. And there is a large literature on the relationships between physical activity, cognition, and educational attainment, young people. And there is some evidence that physical activity can improve cognitive function, particularly attention and memory. And interestingly, these effects have been observed over different timescales. So you may have seen posters today speaking to some of these questions. So there is some evidence that over the long term, engaging in increased physical activity can improve cognitive functions of this type. And we presume that those types of improvements might be mediated by the types of brain changes that I just described to you. There's also some evidence that immediately after a bout of physical activity, certain cognitive functions improve. So implications that might have for education is that if you increase the amount of activity that children are engaging with in school, that might not only improve their longer-term academic outcomes by boosting their brains, but might also immediately improve whatever lesson they're having immediately following the activity they've been engaging in. So there's been a lot of evidence testing for relationships between cognitive performance and physical activity. More limited evidence trying to relate this to academic attainment, although some, a couple of references given there. And again, we need more evidence, we need better evidence in real-life school settings. So I'm just going to show a couple of examples of the types of studies that I'm referring to there. So here's just one looking at the short-term effects. So immediately following a bout of exercise, in this particular relatively small study, immediate cognitive performance was quantified on a couple of different tests. On the left-hand side is a well-known cognitive test called the Flanker test. It's a test of response inhibition and attention. There are two different conditions. So the subject's task is to identify whether a central arrow is pointing to the left or the right. And the central arrow is flanked by the two other arrows, which might either be pointing in the same direction, which is a congruent condition, or in a different direction, which is an incongruent condition. And as you'd expect, the congruent condition is easier than the incongruent condition. And what this study found was better performance in the incongruent condition immediately following a bout of exercise. I should say other studies have found mixed findings with a similar type of test. On the right-hand side is examples of a reading comprehension test, again taken immediately after bout exercise, with some evidence of increased scores on this reading comprehension test. There have been a small number of studies on longer-term academic outcomes in children. Here's an example of a relatively large study from the US. In 24 primary schools, so about 1,500 pupils, where they were looking at sort of inserting physical activity within the curriculum and found evidence that you can see here for bigger improvements in maths and Sunday schools in the students that had this exercise intervention compared to control schools. And looking cross-sectionally, so across large numbers of students, there's pretty robust evidence for associations, so correlations between fitness levels and academic attainment. So in general, physically fit children tend to be better at school. This is shown, this is data from a review paper, sort of pooling across studies, and is shown here on the left for maths achievement, on the right for reading achievement, where you see that in general, children who are fitter tend to be better on both maths and reading. Obviously, there's many, many different explanations about association, but the associations that I see there. And interestingly, these types of associations might have potentially have particular relevance to certain subgroups of people. So, for example, we're interested in whether there might be more scope to make a difference with physical activity interventions in disadvantaged children. So there's evidence that disadvantaged children in general tend to have lower levels of physical activity, reduced measures of cognitive performance, and lower academic performance. So given that these three things tend to be related to one another, one might propose that by intervening on the physical activity, So physical activity then is shown to be related to cognition, is shown to be related to brain function and structure. Another reason why physical activity levels might be relevant to educational outcomes is because of the association between physical activity and psychosocial factors, where again there's a lot of correlations have been reported. So it's well established that increased physical activity can have beneficial effects on mood and various other mental health measures. So for example, physically active children tend to report more positive scores in terms of their own physical self-esteem or how they see themselves in terms of their physical capacities. They have lower scores on depression indices and increased feelings of well-being. So studies that have probed mental well-being in students through questionnaire measures in most cases tend to find associations between higher physical fitness and so again, given the relationships that have been well established between mental health and well-being and attainment, that might suggest that that physical activity could be a route in to then improving academic outcomes via effects on mental health and well-being. But again, the mechanisms by which those effects might manifest themselves might be are unclear. So there are many reasons why improving mood and well-being might then have beneficial effects on attainment. So for example, it might be that after improving mood and well-being, pupils will show improved overall self-esteem, so not just in relation to their physical self-esteem. You might see better behavioural levels, less absence from school, potentially more better sleep. So one of the posters that I was at this morning, your poster, which was very interestingly in this area around physical activity and sleep, one of the hypotheses and your exploring is whether some of the beneficial effects of activity on cognitive outcomes could be mediated through the effects of activity on sleep, which are well established. The more active people are during the day, the better they tend to sleep overnight. And it's well established that the better people sleep overnight, the better they perform cognitive tests the next day. But again, as I keep saying, we need more and better and bigger evidence in schools to really establish how relevant this is to educational practice. So what I've tried to do then in that first section, just to summarise, is that there is an awful lot of evidence that suggests there are relationships between physical activity, cognition, brain health measures, and mental health metrics. So these things all relate to one another, such that increased physical activity is generally a good thing for all of those different variables. Okay, so therefore, there is a framework for thinking that by increasing physical activity, we might improve academic outcomes through a number of potential different routes. So what is the current state of physical activity in school? Is there scope to change something? Or are our children maxing out in terms of the amount of physical activity that they're doing in school? So what's the current state of play when it comes to physical activity in school? The first thing to note is just that it's well recognised that activity that children are doing at school offers a real opportunity to shape our children's future. So as Dame Sarah Davis, the former chief medical officer, noted in her report, early life events are clearly critical in shaping children's future health and well-being, particularly during times of rapid brain growth, so in early years and adolescence. So there's a real opportunity to get in and do something about children's development at this time. And the data in terms of what the state of play in school is suggests that there's huge scope to make a difference there. So there's quite a lot of data on this slide, so I'll talk you through it bit by bit. It basically says during school year, pupils aren't doing a huge amount of physical activity, is the takeaway message. So the graph on the left summarizes a few different studies which quantify the amount. So this, remember, this moderate to vigorous physical activity is the golden intensity of activity that we're trying to achieve, which is activity that gets your heart beating faster and gets you breathing faster. The target, the government target, is that 50% of school PE lessons are spent in moderate to vigorous physical activity. The graph on the left reports from a few different studies, and there are many more with very similar types of results, which quantify what proportion of a school PE lesson is spent in this target zone of moderate to severe physical activity. Take our messages that between 15 and 40% of the lessons actually spent doing activities that increase your heart rate. So there's huge amounts of the school PE lessons that are not active. So we suggest that then there is real scope for doing something about that, but increasing the proportion of the lesson that is consists of actually getting the heart rate. Obviously, there's an awful lot of other stuff that PE teachers have to fit within the PE lesson. That's why the activity, that's part of the reason for the activity lessons are low. So on the right-hand side, you see, on the right-hand side, you see a breakdown of the proportion of the lesson that are spent in different types of activity. Ignore the percentages. They don't have quantity size of the sections. Observer people have spotted. So the size of these segments on the pie chart show you what proportion of an average PE lesson is spent in fitness activity in green, or general knowledge, for example, in orange. So you can see that there's roughly the same proportion of an average lesson that's spent doing a fitness activity as is spent with the teacher imparting general knowledge to the students. The percentages superimposed on the graph show you what the proportion of that type of activity is, this moderate to vigorous physical activity. So you can see that when the children are engaged in fitness activities, they are getting active, as you hope, so they are making the heart beat faster. Whereas when they're receiving general knowledge information from the PE teacher, the activity level is very, very low, like 2% of that time. So we would suggest that there's scope then for trying to work with teachers to think about how can they make the lessons more active while retaining the different types of content that we need to retain. Interestingly also, huge amounts of the yellow segment here is management. That's largely getting to and from the changing rooms and the place where the PE lesson is happening and getting changed. So large amounts of the lessons are taking on those types of activities. We recognise that there are lots of different things that PE teachers have fit into lessons, both because of practicalities like any change and because of curriculum requirements. And that's why I underline that we would want to be working with teachers to think about how can we adapt lessons in such a way to optimise the content of those lessons for brain and cognitive function. Okay, so for the last little section of the talk, I want to tell you a little bit about the specific trial that we're involved in this area, which is a fit to study trial that I mentioned earlier. This was not one of the programs funded by the Education Endowment Foundation and Wellcome. You heard earlier today about the scheme, which has funded a number of the projects that are presenting at this meeting, where the aim of that overall call for projects was to use insights from neuroscience to improve education. So we went into this project with the type of evidence that I've just explained to you, which provided a starting point in which we wanted to test whether physical activity intervention had an impact on academic outcomes. So the aim of the project is to test whether we can raise academic achievement, especially in disadvantaged children. We're testing whether we can do that through a physical exercise intervention, where the intervention consists of a teacher training we deliver to the teachers, which aims to optimise the content of PE lessons for brain and cognitive function. So our hypothesis then is that we'll see improved academic performance in pupils from intervention schools relative to the control schools, and we're also, as neuroscientists and exercise scientists, testing a number of secondary hypotheses, for example, using cognitive tests to see whether we can see improved performance on gift-candle dependence memory tests, and executive function. We're doing a sub-study on brain measures that will come to the range. So the study, which is still ongoing, is focused on pupils in year 8. So these are secondary school pupils about age 12 to 13. And we are using school-level randomization. So schools are randomized to either receive the intervention or to deliver business as usual. So PE as usual without changing their practice. So the intervention, as I mentioned, is that we trained PE teachers last summer on the new programme Element, and the new programme is implemented for 1 year. And deliberately not saying a lot about the intervention because the trial is still ongoing. So if they take my word for it, it's an intervention which is very minimal, with the idea being to include activities which are optimised for brain and cognitive function. The outcomes that we're measuring, so the primary outcome which is being measured by our independent evaluators, that's in social research, is being measured in this coming month and is performed in maths on standardised maths test. And we collected a number of secondary outcomes, some of which are listed here. So we're collecting a lot of cognitive tasks which are being assessed online in the full study sample. These include a simple reaction time test, the flanker test that I mentioned earlier, which is a test of response inhibition. The NMAP test is a working memory test, task switching, which is an executive function test, and a memory test. We also have a number of online questionnaires that the students are doing, which include quite a lot of questions around their attitudes and motivation to activity and exercise, as well as some general questions around well-being, sleep, and physical activity outside of school. So just while we're on the subject of secondary med, so we're in the middle of this trial, as I mentioned, so we're about to acquire the primary outcome this coming month. We've learned an awful lot around along the way, so I'm mainly going to share the sorts of things that we've learned along the way with you today. So one of the things that we've spent a lot of time doing is refining our measures. So we're trying to acquire a number of different secondary measures. And doing this at scale has been incredibly challenging. And a summary of about 3 years worth of iterating around different ways of doing this is provided here. So for example, one of the challenges is that we need, actually I should probably come to the scale of the study. I'll go back to the challenges in a moment, because in order to understand why it was challenging, we have to appreciate the scale of the study. So we had our target for recruitment was 100 secondary schools. And we were lucky enough to be teamed up with the NFL, the National Foundation for Education Research, who are responsible for our recruitment. And they did a fantastic job of this. So they mailed out over 1,000 secondary schools and managed to get 104 schools signed up, roughly from the middle of England to the south and east. And you can see the distribution of schools there. So we managed to get the schools signed up. There have been some challenges in keeping schools on board, so this is, in hindsight, quite a demanding project for the schools, for the teachers involved, partly because of the training that we're having to ask them to do, partly because of the burden of the testing through the secondary measures, etc. So there have been some dropouts at the school level, which you can see illustrated here, but the end result is that we will be measuring the primary outcome in around 77 schools, which we're still pleased with, although it will be interesting to reflect on the reasons for the school and the attrition that we've experienced. So that's around 77 schools that are still engaged, that's probably about 10,000 students. So obviously acquiring new secondary measures and 10,000 students isn't something that we can do in the way that we typically do our experiments. So we typically do our experiments by having somebody come into a quiet laboratory, no distractions, put on some headphones, sit on a laptop with a chin rest and do the cognitive tests in complete isolation, but so we can't do that at this scale, so everything has to be scaled up and done at multiple moves from the researchers, and that's where this learning that I referred to has come into play. So because we're doing everything at multiple moves, we need ways of recruiting, of sort of harvesting that data reliably. And that's something that we're still learning. I'm sure there are many other groups represented in the room who might have more experiences in this area and better insights to offer along these lines. But one thing that we need to be able to capture, for example, is what was the intervention that was actually delivered. So the intervention, as we have delivered it, was to train teachers in these schools, but obviously then the teachers are then released into the wild to deliver what they choose to deliver in their classes. And ideally, we would have a way of capturing what was actually delivered on the ground. And that's something where we have learned a lot over the process, so we have started off with a nice vision of a beautifully designed app that we've got on tablets that we give to schools, and they would sort of seamlessly upload data in real time of what they were doing in the schools. For a number of different reasons, ranging from app development, working across different platforms, Wi-Fi performance in schools, that didn't happen altogether, that there was a paper book that teachers tick box fill in and hopefully send back to us. So that has been a learning process. We have quite successfully managed to monitor activity in the pupils during PE. So we have a fantastic team of research assistants who are going into the schools once a term and capturing PE lessons where the pupils, all of the pupils wear wristband activity monitors which are providing a fantastic set of data on what the activity levels are like in the pupils. Fitness tests, so the teachers as researchers are effectively acquiring these data for us by testing the fitness levels in their pupils. Again, that's something where we have big ideas about computerized automatic uploading of data, which wasn't what the teachers wanted, so again, that's being done on paper. And then finally, we've had an awful lot of challenges around the online tests that we're doing. So I mentioned that we're requiring questionnaire data and requiring cognitive tests. That's something that we have to do online, the way that we're doing this. And so we have worked a lot with schools and teachers in order to find ways of that working effectively. What we have found is that it was impossible to do this in schools. So many reasons, primarily of which is the variability in school IT infrastructure and availability and bandwidth and everything else, and it was possible to do this in schools. For the cognitive test, I should say, so there's different demands. So the questionnaires are relatively straightforward to do online. The challenge with any of these cognitive tests, those of you who do these will know about these challenges, those of you who don't might not appreciate that it's actually not at all trivial to accurately record millisecond precision reaction times online. That's not difficult to come in. So in order to do that, you need these things that are challenging to implement in a school IT setting. So that has been incredibly challenging. Therefore, what we've ended up with is asking people to do this as homework, where it's not possible for them to find school settings. Being doing it at home, as homework raises all sorts of challenges. You have no idea what people are doing, whether they're watching YouTube videos as well, so there's an awful lot of challenges, but we've learned a lot through that process, and that's the kind of thing we're getting people together to share experiences and what's worked, what hasn't worked, and what's really valuable things in these ways. Just a quick word about our imaging sub-study. So we're doing a relatively small brain imaging study with subsets of the pupils from about 15 different schools. We're coming in with different brain measures before and after. So this is where we're up to. So as I said, we spent a few years trying to develop the measures, trying to refine the intervention, piloting some of those measures in school. Even with all that piloting, as we were gathered, we're still learning things as we go along. I talked already about the recruitment and nutrition that we have, some nutrition that we've experienced. Just a few results, because I thought I should put one or two of our results in there. So these are from our baseline data. These are some results from Thomas, which is just giving a couple of insights into the kinds of things we're seeing at baseline, which is that in general, higher fit children do better, have better memory scores, better memory performance, although as you can see there, the effect sizes are tiny. So one, obviously having lots of data is fantastic. On the other hand, once you have large data sets, lots of things end up being significant, particularly once you start looking at correlations. So we have to stop thinking about statistical significance and start thinking about practical significance and effect sizes. And you can see that, yes, there's a highly statistically significant relationship between the variables, but how meaningful is it if it's explaining a tiny proportion of the overall variability in the scores? Just a sort of highlight result from our brain imaging, so these are all pre-intervention results, I should say. Just looking at what characterises fitter children versus less fit children. Here this demonstrates that fitter children and more active children tend to have a thicker cortex in widespread different brain areas. So just to summarise, this has been a fantastically interesting, exciting, worthwhile study to be engaged in. engaged in, but have also been challenged in many different ways, and we hope that the challenges that we've faced in the institution, talking point will guide you to the challenges in similar types of studies and to be able to pool expertise across people, so we don't all keep making the same mistakes that we need. So one of the challenges, so what, as I said in the first half of the talk, what we need is more real-world, properly powered studies in a school setting. However, those are hard. So the scale of the study, which is what was needed in order to be able to power to detect the type of subtle effects that we're expecting to see, was a massive recruitment challenge, which we were lucky because we were able to outsource that. However, at that scale, there was a huge challenge of how you assess people at scale, and how you acquire the types of secondary measures that you're interested in at scale. Logistically, these studies are hard because the school year keeps going, even if you're not ready for it to keep going. And that's not something that you're used to, having that previously worked in school. So the timeline is very, very challenging. I mentioned that we have challenges with school attrition. That would be very interesting to get the evaluations from our teachers of what the key movement is, things like the burden and what we're asking of people who are already massively overburdened with their core responsibilities. Mentioned online testing already. And then just finally something that I haven't mentioned, so the control group here is a business as usual control. Clearly that is a relevant control if we're wanting to get evidence as to whether or not we should change things relative to business as usual. But from the perspective of the scientists, it's a frustrating control because if we were to get the results whereby the physical activity intervention had an effect over the part of business as usual, we as scientists would not know why we got that result, which for us would be frustrating. However, on the other hand, we recognise that that's a level of evidence that we need in order to do something about what's being practiced in the schools. So that's an interesting discussion for us. So in conclusion, then, there's strong evidence that physical activity influences brain cognition. And so we propose that optimising opportunities for physical activity in school might have benefits not only for physical and mental health, which are really, really valuable benefits, but also for academic attainment. However, more evidence is required in real-world settings at a scale, and new studies are really important. So thanks very much for your attention.
Thank you for your talk and for this great overview. I have a question regarding the effects that you show in relation to brain development. So in the first half of your talk, you specifically focus on the hippocampus as a specific brain region and in terms of its function in memory, maybe. And towards the very end, you also show the relationship between physical activity and cortical thickness. So I'm interested in the effects of physical activity on more the cortical brain regions, that like the prefrontal cortex or the temporal cortex, that have been shown to play an important role on learning specifically. And could you, in your answer, refer to the developmental pathways of these regions across adolescence? So are there specific, or what specific effects would you expect, considering the fact that across adolescence we see a thinning of the cortical context, the cortex in these regions, and you just showed a positive relationship, so I'm also intrigued about the effects of, in which direction would you expect it to have effects?
Yeah, there's a whole range of questions. So it is true that a lot of the literature that's out there is focused on the hippocampus. Part of that is probably an accident of the... So in the animal studies, for example, you can only really look at one brain region. And because of neurogenesis is something that is particularly important in the campus, a lot of that literature is focused on the hippocampus. That has nothing to say about the other, about the cortex, for example, because people simply haven't looked. With most of the human brain region studies, it would be possible, as you probably know, to look wider. Some studies have looked more broadly, many, and some haven't. Where people have looked more broadly, there is evidence for effects, particularly around prefrontal cortex. There is, as you say, prefrontal cortex is, as many people probably know, the area of the brain that develops most, has the most protracted course of development, so continues to develop even into our 20s, particularly in terms of the white matter pathways that project into the prefrontal cortex. So it is an area that would be very receptive to changes in environment and lifestyle throughout adolescence and early adulthood. And this also includes all of our brain areas that are incredibly relevant to many of the cognitive functions that we underlie academic. So I'm sure you're right that there would be an awful lot of interest going on in the prefrontal cortex. There's an interesting point you made about the direction of association. So this was a very preliminary cross-section result. What would be great is to be able to actually look at trajectories of change. So with these kids being 12, 13, I don't know on the sort of trajectory of increasing versus pruning, I guess they would be starting to get towards pruning, whether you have a flat baseline or a declining baseline, I'm not sure. But it's an important question. Ideally, you need to have trajectories rather than just a single cycle to look at the brain changes.
Your projects are most very impressed by the size and the scope of the study. But as you are already aware of it, there are a lot of mediators involved in this study between individual level and the school level. I wonder what kind of school level mainly you're projecting to see how schools impact as interfering between your intervention and individual.
Yes, it's a very good question. So the main school level variables that we would take into account would be urban, rural, and proportion of free school meals. So in the UK, there's sort of socioeconomic status proxy measure that is commonly used to categorise the schools as the proportion of children who receive free school meals. So the two groups in the control group and the intervention group at the school level are well matched on urban, rural, gender, and the free school meal status of the schools. So those are the variables that you can take into account at the school level.
Thank you for the talk. There's other calls for some interested in hearing. And so, Freddy, this might be a theoretical question. So, why do you think it is that it affects primarily the incumbents, and why do you think that affects the cognition? So, the mechanisms that you can
Yeah, it's a very good question. So there's lots of classic literature that suggests that the hippocampus is special when it comes to certain brain plasticity processes such as neurogenesis. Recently, that's all kind of controversial, but if we look at the decades of evidence before that, there seem to be some special features of the hippocampus when it comes to particularly growth of new neurons, and maybe it's a location that's particularly susceptible to incoming growth factors and the types of things that influence your own growth. So maybe because of the sort of special biology of the hippocampus, and or it might be because of the functions that it's involved in, that particularly prevalently implicated in lots of different functions that are relevant. It might partly be an almost accident, as I mentioned, of the evolution of the literature in this area that has come out of a focus on that brain region from the animal literature. So there's always a risk that people have been looking in one place, whereas actually there's a lot more going on, for example, in the prefrontal cortex. There's not been many studies that have compared across different brain regions.
Thank you for your talk. I have a question in terms of why. Why do you find this link between sports and these brain mechanisms? So in terms of neurobiology and in terms of phylogenetics, do you have any idea of why?
Yeah, so at the biological level, it seems that, so there's many different things happening, obviously, when we're physically active. So there is an increased blood flow to the brain and increased oxygenation, and then there seems to be an increase in growth factor. So there's an awful lot biologically that's happening both during and just after exercise, such that the biological environment has got more various things that are then potentially beneficial for brain plasticity and brain growth. So that's the sort of broad brush biological background, something which would be a very systemic effect. Obviously, those types of vascular changes that happen in association with energy usage would be very systemic. So those sorts of pathways wouldn't predict any specificity to the effects that you would see. So that would be just in terms of driving the physical activity of the organism. You said sport, which is interesting, so it may be the case that individuals talk, but different types of physical activity or sport are more beneficial than others. So certainly there is evidence that, for example, more cognitively demanding activities or more social activities or outdoor activities, there's an awful lot of features of the activity which seem to boost that basic biological effect of increasing blood flow to the brain. So that in general, if you were to do a group, a team sport in the park that was very cognitively demanding would probably be better, or would be better, than going on a treadmill on your own in the shed. So it's not just about the very basic biological energy utilisation. It probably is a lot going on about the context of the activity as well, what you have going into at all in this way, and what it's going to happen.
Yeah, I think it would be interesting to find those factors. Also then, it's important to know what is doing the control group.
Yeah.
Because if you want to answer that factor, it would play a role. But also in terms of phylogenetics, why do you think there is such a link between the body and the mind? Do you have an idea in terms of
Yeah.
I mean, it's more a philosophical question.
Yeah.
I like it, sorry.
Yeah, that's an interesting I'm not sure I have any useful insights as to from an evolutionary perspective as to whether it's something that has evolved in that way or just accidents of the biology. That's an issue. And you'll probably talk about control, but yes, from our perspective as scientists, the business as usual control is very frustrating because it means you can't answer anything about the why question from this study, but I think you need most of the studies that address the why question aren't done at the scale that they are to have any real knowledge. So it's very hard, and even for our people who are managing to do both, it's very hard to do this.
Hi, thanks again. And my question is about adult variables actually filled with cognitive function. So it has been shown that, for instance, education and labeling will increase the volume of hippocampus. And even just playing games, particular games, will increase the abilities, different kinds of abilities, and will change with this being great. And music will change. And that's one, there are many variables like that. So I have two questions. The first is, how do you come to balance for those variables in your study? And the other one is, there might be some sort of mechanism behind all of this. Do you have any idea about that? And when you make recommendations of you must go for physical activity 2 hours per day or so, maybe it should be a combination of physical activity, music, and games, and so on. So.
Yes, yeah, no, I don't disagree with you. So in terms of potential compounding variables, yes, everything we do will have an impact on our brain. And we haven't captured all of those things, so like gaming, for example, or music. I guess you control for it, so there's a study we've randomized at the school level, and I mentioned that we tried to match the schools on certain variables at the school level. There will be some things that we're not capturing in terms of levels of musicality across the different schools, but one would hope that at this scale that will be cast out. Your second question now is, schools for urban, rural, and
social
policies effectively.
And can we have any idea of the underlying
mechanisms
that could be actually governing all of that?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, as I mentioned, we can't speak to the why at the sort of biological level. So it's possible there's a sort of very basic biological effect on relationship. It is possible there's another mediator. So I mentioned sleep, for example. So my best guess is as a intermediary that could be mediating the beneficial effect of cognition would be sleep and mood. So there's very well established links between increasing activity and better sleep and improved mood, and those might be direct or indirect. We are capturing all the rather clearly both sleep and mood in the main trial, so we will be testing those pathways, those potential pathways.